Hello. This presentation will be on breast cancer screening. The learning objectives will be to understand the goals behind screening, learning the risk factors for breast cancer, and understanding the controversies behind the current screening guidelines. Here's a brief outline of the topics. And here's a common clinical scenario. A 43-year-old woman comes to your clinic concerned about breast cancer. Her mother died of breast cancer when she was 68, and she wants to avoid the same fate. She's currently asymptomatic and has no past medical history of note. She experienced menarche at 12, has one son who gave birth to at 31, and currently takes no oral contraceptive pills. She has never had a mammogram. What would your advice be for this patient? Epidemiology. Worldwide, breast cancer accounts for 23% of all cancer cases. In women, it is the most commonly diagnosed cancer, as well as the leading cause of cancer death. In general, the increasing industrialization of a nation is correlated with an increase in the incidence of breast cancer. However, over the last 20 years, many developed countries have also shown a decrease in the mortality from breast cancer. This is likely due to both an increase in the availability of adjuvant therapy, as well as improvements in the availability and knowledge of breast cancer screening programs. Screening. Screening involves the evaluation of a group of asymptomatic individuals who are at risk for a given disease. The goal of screening is to detect a disease at an earlier stage, at which point steps can be taken to minimize the morbidity or mortality associated with the condition. Screening programs should only be instituted when there is evidence that the screening technique is effective. Resources and personnel are available to carry out the screening in the target population in an equitable manner. Facilities exist for confirming the diagnosis, treatment, and follow-up for those with abnormal results, and the prevalence of disease is high enough to justify screening the target population. The most common examples for successful population screening are mammography for detecting breast cancer and pap smears for cervical cancer. For breast cancer, the goal of screening is the early detection of precancerous and cancerous lesions. Risk factors. The average lifetime risk for developing breast cancer by age 90 in the United States is 13%. However, the risk of breast cancer is not distributed equally across the population. For example, a woman in her 40s has a 0.6% chance of developing breast cancer in the next 5 years, whereas a woman in her 70s has a 2.2% chance. Overall, rates rise sharply after the age of 40, reach a peak around 70 to 74, and then gradually decline thereafter. It almost goes without saying that gender is also one of the most significant factors for breast cancer. It occurs 100 times more frequently in women than men. These two predictors of risk, age and sex, have served as the basis for screening guidelines in many countries. Most nationwide screening programs begin screening women at a certain age and recommend screening until a certain age is reached as well. It would not be cost-effective to start screening women below the age of 40, as the incidence of breast cancer is so low. Likewise, at a certain age, the natural course of breast cancer exceeds the life expectancy of the individual, and therefore screening makes little sense. However, although these national guidelines are a good rule of thumb to use as a baseline for the general population, other risk factors exist that may significantly modify a woman's lifetime or 5-year risk for breast cancer. Factors such as BRCA1 or 2 mutations significantly increase the chance that a woman will develop breast cancer, and it means that the women will need to be screened more aggressively, perhaps more frequently or by utilizing different methodologies. The most popular tool that combines multiple risk factors to calculate risk is the Breast Cancer Assessment Tool, or BCRAT. It takes into account age, age of menarche, age of first live birth, number of first-degree relatives with breast cancer, number of breast biopsies, whether any biopsy has shown atypical hyperplasia, and race, and uses all these values to calculate a woman's individual risk for developing breast cancer over the next 5 years, as well as the risk until the age of 90. Patients should be cautioned that it is only an approximate measure of risk and does not incorporate several details, such as BRCA status. BCRAT has a sensitivity of 28 to 44% and a specificity of 66 to 88% in predicting which women will develop breast cancer. Another model, BRCA Pro, attempts to include the likelihood that a woman has a deleterious BRCA1 or BRCA2 gene based on family history in its calculation of breast cancer. Although some data shows that it is a better predictor than BCR-ATit is still imperfect and does not take into account a whole host of minor risk factors as well as non-BRCA genetic impact. Despite their imperfections, tools such as BCR-ATand BRCA-PRO have important roles. They provide risk information, 5-year and lifetime, in an easy-to-understand manner. Furthermore, they allow the clinician to determine whether a patient is at high risk, generally considered to be a lifetime risk greater than 20-25%, and hence needs to be referred to a specialist for counseling, genetic testing, and potentially specialized screening. This table highlights many of the risk factors and protective factors associated with breast cancer and their corresponding relative risks. Mammography. Mammography is the most commonly used modality in breast cancer screening programs to detect early asymptomatic breast cancer. It involves exposing the breast to x-rays in at least two views. In the craniocaudal view, the breast is compressed from above, and in the mediolateral oblique view, the breast is compressed and imaged from the side. Sufficient compression is vital to obtaining good mammograms, but may cause the patient significant pain. Techniques such as using topical lidocaine gel, radiolucent cushions, or patient-controlled compression may help to reduce anxiety and discomfort. Whether or not mammography itself has reduced breast cancer mortality is a harder question to answer. Although there has been a 30% reduction in breast cancer mortality since 1990 in the U.S., new medications such as tamoxifen and aromatase inhibitors have also played a significant role. A few studies have attempted to answer this question and determined that screening is responsible for reducing mortality by 2-10%. More than half of the mortality reduction seen is actually due to optimized patient treatment. A large study, DMIST, found that in comparison to film mammography, digital mammography may be more accurate for premenopausal and perimenopausal women, as well as women with dense breasts. Computer-assisted detection, CAD, increases the ability of the radiologist to detect calcifications. However, it is also associated with an increase in the number of false positives, as well as the increase in the detection of ductal carcinoma in situ. Because the natural history of DCIS is indolent and uncertain, no studies have shown CAD to improve mortality over normal mammograms. Double reading, where two radiologists review each mammogram, has been shown to increase the detection of breast cancer by 10% and is currently the standard in most European countries, although it does increase the cost of screening. In terms of the optimal frequency of screening, very little data exists. Breast cancers in older women tend to grow more slowly, so many national guidelines allow for longer gaps between screening for women over the age of 50. The most specific finding on mammography for malignancy is a spiculated soft tissue mass, which is 90% specific for invasive cancer. Clustered macular calcifications represent intraductal calcifications in areas with necrotic tumor and are seen in 60% of malignancies. Linear branching calcifications have a high predictive value for malignancy, especially high-grade DCIS. Large coarse calcifications or round smooth calcifications are not suspicious for malignancy. Significant architectural distortion can also hint at malignancy. The mammographic report will usually include a BI-RADS final assessment, which can be interpreted in the following manner. 0 is an incomplete assessment. 1, negative findings. 2, benign findings, fibroadenomas or cysts. 3, probably benign findings, the likelihood of malignancy is less than 2%, short interval follow-up is recommended. 4, suspicious abnormality, likelihood of malignancy ranges from 2 to 94%, depending on which subdivision of 4 the radiologist is referring to. 4A, the chance of malignancy is 2 to 9%. 4B, the chance is 10 to 49%, and 4C, the chance is 50 to 94%. Biopsy should be considered at this point. 5, is highly suggestive of malignancy. The likelihood is 95 to 100%. This occurs when spiculations can be seen or pleomorphic calcifications. And 6, is a biopsy-proven malignancy. Other approaches to screening. MRI. Magnetic resonance imaging requires the injection of IV contrast material and costs significantly more than mammography. In general, studies have shown MRI to be more sensitive and less specific in detecting breast cancer. No mortality benefit was seen when used as a general screening tool. They are therefore only recommended in women at high risk, for example, those women with BRCA mutations. Thermography. based on the principle that women have a slightly elevated skin temperature over their breast cancers, although a device was approved by the FDA, it has an extremely high false negative rate, greater than 60%. No organization recommends thermography, clinical breast exam. In large randomized trials, mammography detected 90% of cancers versus 50% for CBE. However, other studies have shown that CBE in the community setting detected 5% of cancers that were not visible on mammography. Therefore, although specificity seems to be high in asymptomatic women, 96.2%, sensitivity is low, 36.1%. Overall, CBE may be a viable alternative in areas such as developing countries where mammography may not be relatively available to use as a screening tool. Self-breast exam. Most studies do not show a significantly increased detection or improvement in mortality with self-breast examination. In fact, some studies demonstrate the rate of biopsy for benign disease is higher in the self-examination group. Recommendations by expert groups. There is consensus for routine screening with mammography, with or without clinical breast examination, for women age 50 and older. Screening should be continued until 74 or until life expectancy is less than 5 to 10 years. Opinions differ, however, on screening women in their 40s. The United States Preventive Services Task Force does not recommend routine screening for women in their 40s. This is based mainly on findings of the AGE trial, the first trial to specifically focus on women in their 40s, which found that mammography resulted in a non-significant reduction of breast cancer-related mortality in this age group. Therefore, the USPSTF recommends biennial screening starting from the age of 50. In contrast, the American Cancer Society and the American College of Radiology recommend starting routine yearly screening at age 40. They criticize the AGE trial for only using single-view mammography, not reaching the target sample size, and only having a 70% compliance rate. The ACS recommends yearly screening because of the faster growth rate of breast cancer, as well as the lower sensitivity of mammograms due to increased breast density in the younger cohort. Most groups have also recommended using MRI as a screening tool in high-risk groups of women, those who have a known mutation, are likely to have a mutation based on family history, or those who, due to a combination of various risk factors, have a high lifetime or five-year risk of developing breast cancer. The importance of breast self-exam has also been de-emphasized. Summary. Breast cancer screening for an individual should take into account multiple risk factors, ideally in a risk prediction model. Individuals who are at higher risk for breast cancer should be seen by a specialist, be counseled about their increased risk, and screened yearly with an MRI. For the general population, screening with mammography is still the gold standard. Digital mammography should be used in premenopausal women or a woman with dense breasts. Screening should begin at either 40 on an annual basis, or at 50 and occur biennially. It should continue until a woman is 74 or until her life expectancy is less than 5 to 10 years.